Hello everyone, I'm Thomas Burnichon. I'm ATEM Director of Technology, filling in for Michael Rollet, our Director of Research and Innovation. And I'm here today to discuss how emerging formats will basically change the way we do streaming. So over the course of the session today, we've seen that the traditional approach of using a fixed ladder with basically one-size-fits-all sets of parameters is not good to optimize your streaming. So using a content adaptive approach makes more sense. It's the current state of the art. We can use VBR, we can use a variable set of profiles, variable resolution, even things like dynamic chunking. And our stance at ATEM is that by doing it with a full stack control, meaning that you own completely your technology and can tweak every pieces along the way, you get much more flexibility and you are ready to cope with the changes that are to come. So what kind of change? So the highlights I'll give today are about 8K and high frame rate. So to give practical working points, those are two assets I'll go through. One is courtesy of the Explorers, a group of documentaries shooting people working with French broadcaster TF1. It's in HDR, it's shot on a Red Helium, so it's an 8K but before debayer. And the other sample is Tour de France, shot on a custom firmware of Sony camera by our friends at France Télévisions, again in HDR, and courtesy of ISO. If you want to run your own test, we can facilitate content exchange, just contact us. To start with resolution and the first Polynesian content, what's interesting to draw is a typical rate distortion curve where we use our own ATEM quality index to kind of map how every profile behave. And then what people do is to try and stick to the conventional of all those curves so that you are set on an optimal path of content adaptive profiles. What's to take away of this slide is that even in 8K, resolution remains the main driving factor behind your bitrate choices. So moving from HD to 4K, we saw a factor of about 3 in bitrate increase. Now moving from 4K to 8K, we are still above 2. The good news is that it's reducing. That's the graph on the left. There's a paper you can refer to with more details. But basically, this will still govern your choices moving forward. If we look at the other content, we can start by plotting the same graph and seeing a same inflection point, but this time between HD and 4K. What was interesting to note, going back a little bit on the previous one, is that we were actually changing from 4K to 8K below 20 Mbps, which is extremely low. That's more something you would expect for the VVC codec Benjamin presented. Again, here it's a really easy content, aerial shot, so don't take that as a general rule. But it also explains and highlights the fact that you need to use and deploy content adaptive techniques to be able to lower the rate when you can. Tour de France is more complex, so we are back to moving from HD to 4K around 20 Mbps. And if we plot graphs using frame rate reduction this time instead of resolution reduction, you see that it's much more collapsed together, which means that frame rate, as at least in this example, although it's a complex and high motion scene, frame rate has less impact. In fact, you will start to reduce your frame rate only when you are really, really bit starved. And that can be highlighted by the about 10% increase in bitrate that you can either add or save by doubling the frame rate. It's a common misconception that high frame rate will cause a very high bandwidth strain on the delivery side. It's not true. Of course, it's true in the uncompressed domain and the production side, but for delivery, high frame rate is not a problem at all. What gets interesting is when you combine all this, because we use this quality index that is working cross codec and cross resolution, and cross frame rate. We can compare many things together. And here what you see is that, for example, the purple line, which is the third from the top, shows you that in this example, HD at 100 FPS brings a better user experience than UHD at 25 FPS. And that's a common discussion around sports people. High frame rate has more appeal than higher resolution. This approach is very generic, can be applied for many things. I just mentioned cross codec. I think in today's presentation, we've seen that we have new codec coming up, AV1, VVC. So it's important to have a content adaptive technology that can embrace that. And of course, HDR, if you own your content and you can choose if you want to deliver SDR or HDR, it can be interesting to have a way to actually quantify the perceived benefit of moving to HDR and arbitrate that against other use of that additional bitrate. Today, in the Apple specs, there's just a brutal increase of 20% on the bitrate. We can be much more fine about it for HDR. Without diving into too much detail, basically, we use this adaptive, attempt quality index deep down in our encoder to drive the decision. Of course, the main challenge is to remain real time for live and at a decent speed for file. So we need to deploy a technique to make sure that we keep that complexity in check. And one point already mentioned today is to use artificial intelligence technique with directed learning phase with a posteriori analysis on our side, on a preferably big data set. And then in production, use more of a priori method to basically narrow down the realm of possibilities and then still make good encoding choices. So our strategy there is really to isolate different parameters. You see we have an index for spatial aspect, for temporal aspect, of course for compression efficiency, also for color gamut and dynamic range. So we teach the algorithm for each of those aspects individually to reduce the complexity of the problem. Then, in the end, we end up with what we call a tree of possibilities. And the good approach here is to define business rules, usually, to select what makes sense for you to deploy. So you can have a constraint to have a specific profile for a specific device you're targeting. So the ability to define that independently from the research I mentioned before allow you to reach an actual usable product. So it's very flexible. This part does not actually use artificial intelligence. It's a more traditional pruning approach. And just to conclude, the results on those two specific sequences. For Polynesi going up to 8K, we went again below 20 Mbps, which is quite a feat, but that's a specific asset. And if you compare that to the traditional Apple recommendation, you see that we can basically reduce the rate by a factor of 80%. And even if we squeeze 8K on top of the recommendation, but obviously today do not include 8K, we are still at a very significant saving rate above 50%. Now for Tour de France, we are back to a more traditional 20 Mbps for UHD, but this time at 100 FPS. And if you compare that to the Apple recommendation, we are still securing a safe 30% saving. Again, two examples with those new format coming up with 8K and higher frame rate. Right on time, any question?
I don't see a question. Okay, then merci Thomas, thank you very much.
Enjoy the break, thanks.